Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Carriage House, and thank you all for coming. Tonight we start our 19th year as a poetry series, so it's really a big deal for us. Yeah. Not applauses for everybody, our readers, our open readers, our audience members. Some of you probably know this story already, but 19 years ago, when I started the series, I was on chemo. And that first night, I didn't feel very well at all. And Jerry Stern was our first reader. And after I closed up and I went outside, it was December, it was cold. I stood out there in the cold and I looked up at this building and I said, you know, Carriage House, you've been standing a long time. I want to stand with you. And here we are, 19 years later. So, pretty wonderful. The Carriage House has been blessed, and so have I. We have two very special readers tonight. I think they're two of the nicest people I know, good friends who have been involved in the poetry scene in Union County in New Jersey for many, many years, and they are real-life sweethearts. As you know, in February, we like to do Sweetheart Night, and the one rule that we have is that they must be really sweethearts. They can't just be people who write love poems. They can be sweethearts and they don't have to read any love poems at all, but they must be sweethearts. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to introduce them together from here, and then they will read one at a time, and they can tell you a little bit about themselves and their romance and read their poems. Amanda Berry is, who's going to read first? Amanda, you or Tony? Amanda, okay. Amanda Berry lives in Garwood. Her chapbook of poems, Second Sight, was published by Finishing Line Press. She appeared here at the Carriage House a number of years ago as Emily Dickinson in one of our special productions. And her writing has appeared in Edison Literary Review, English Journal, Birmingham Poetry Review, and other publications. She teaches middle school English at the Kent Place School in Summit. Now, her sweetheart, Tony Grunewald, lives in Edison. He's the author of The Secret History of New Jersey. His poems have appeared in the New York Times, Exit 13 magazine, Edison Literary Review, Mas Tequila Review, and elsewhere. He's worked in broadcast journalism and advertising. So please join me in welcoming Amanda Berry and Tony Grunewald.
If you don't mind, I will sit. I want to thank Adele for having us here. She's always been such a wonderful supporter of my work and of poetry in general, and so we're just so grateful to be here. It's a privilege to be able to read here at the Carriage House, and I love it here. Sweetheart night, but I don't really write love poems, so we'll just read what I do write. Start off with one that's sort of a love poem. It's about a kind of love, in a way. It's called Marinade. It has an epigraph, which is from a food writer named Patrick O'Connell. And the epigraph reads, "They give people good things to eat so they won't be eaten themselves, a primitive survival tactic." She remembers the courtship of her second marriage, long romantic strolls on the beach, how he pointed out every variety of mollusk and crustacean and told her how he would prepare each one. Now they return to the island with children and grocery bags, bulging with scallions, coffee, and bread, lug the wagons down the rutted path to the cottage with a narrow kitchen and a large table. She calls in friends to fill the empty places. He serves up shrimp sauteed in butter with white rice, grilled chickens, string beans. They revel in meat, pay a fortune for ice cream that melts in the heat. He regales guests in the kitchen with details of recipes, names secret spice mixtures categorically, leans back against the counter with the dish towel over his shoulder, pondering menus. She wakes from her nap with the baby, seeking cake. "He's a good man," she says, "a devoted father. People like him, and he's the best cook." There are times, she admits, when she lies that she's ill, retires to the third floor, hungry. At summer's end, a pool party evolves into evening feast as he turns out bowls of slippery noodles and marinated things. On the porch, she pleads with baby to eat as she mashes chunks of chicken into steamed rice. In the yard, wet children slurping slices of watermelon drip in the grass. As long as we're on food, this one is called Dish. Have you heard, she said, as we sat at a table for two on the street. You won't believe it. Breathless, bracelets bangling, she picked up a small curved knife. I probably shouldn't be telling you this. Dipped into the pot of spreadable cheese, slathered a glob onto crisp bread, smoothed precisely into each corner with a twist of the wrist, then held it from the edges between her thumb and second finger, elbow propped on the table. And wait, there's more. As she leaned in closer to finish her story, I was ready to bite. I guess as most poets, I'm a people watcher. I like to watch the world go by, and this is one that came the window of a bus. It's called Departure. Idling in midtown traffic, we hovered in the meanwhile before red turned to green and traffic reawakened. I watched out the window of an uptown bus, intruder on a scene, as laughter and voices filtered, muted through double panes of glass. Their faces beamed and held tightly to the weekend, wholeheartedly, embracing the ones departing. Kneeling to kiss the child. Before my bus pulled away, I watched as bags and hangers were loaded into the trunk with one last hug and promises exchanged. How long will gladness linger after love leaves? When the car door banged shut, finally, only two were left behind, waving from the sidewalk. Her fingers fluttered, then floated to her side. It grew quiet and there was no breeze. She examined her shoes and kicked at the pavement, holding back her hair. He shifted his weight, then fumbled with the zipper on his backpack, rummaging around for something lost. I didn't see the light turn, but as the bus engine roared, then droned, dragging us onward, I lost sight of them, standing alone on the curb. This is one that I wrote for my grandmother, and it's a story that she told me about her mother, whom she loved dearly, who died when she was young. And I'd like to welcome my aunt who's here visiting with us this evening, and so I'll dedicate this one to you. It's called Ice. You speak of your mama still in hushed tones, of her gentle goodness and weak lungs. Perhaps she used up too much breath, birthing eight babies, so when she sickened and took to her bed, the house was left to cradle them. The only remedy was fresh air, so Papa built her a sleeping porch on the side of the house over the parlor. He was a sturdy builder of houses, and he had pounded together the family fortress on a hillside facing East River Mountain, which loomed a constant sentinel. Papa moved Mama's bed to the sleeping porch where, even in winter, she could sleep beneath heavy quilts in the top branches of the alder bush and breathe in pure night. Once in the quiet early hours, you heard her slow footsteps across the floor above. By then, she had not moved from the bed for weeks, but she rose and crept again to the front window, needing to see the mountain draped in clouds. You were only 10, but when her cough rattled the floorboards, you knew to fetch a block of ice from the cold closet and wrap it in a flour sack. Cracked ice mixed with sugar and whiskey would soothe for a time. Your slight frame grasped Papa's hammer with both hands and pounded against the mound of ice, pounded against the chill, against the cough and the pain, and a child's need. The blows, glancing, chipped slivers, all your strength nicking at the solid block, iron to ice, grinding it down into broken bits. And a lot of what I write is about family or inspired by family, and this was inspired by my sister years ago. It's called Trailer Park. Just when we thought winter would never leave, two little sprigs of forsythia appeared, joined at the hip in the yard of her new trailer, the third home in as many years. One built into a hill of dirt, now foreclosed. A second outgrown with its low ceilings and cold linoleum. Here, the railroad rooms seem to go on and on, freshly painted plyboard covering stains of previous lives, counters open on all sides from window to window, space after space spilling over onto porches in front and back where scrubbed plastic chairs overlook the downhill slope of matted grasses waiting for green. Surely she has spent enough years facing uphill. The yard tumbles past the shoulder-high saplings and beyond to the two yellow sprigs raised like frail, sunny wings. And of course I have to read one for my son, who's now 20 years old and 6 foot six, but I have quite a few poems I wrote when he was little. Before I had him, I said, I'm not going to be one of those poets who writes about their children all the time. But of course, after he was born, that's about all I could write about for a while. And I was looking back through some poems and I realized it's better than a photo album because I have so many conversations that we had when he was little in my poems or in notes that I've written, and I love having those to remind me. This one is called Unfathomable. He recites his credo of bold-faced facts, informs me at the table, a tarantula can be as big as a dinner plate. Who thought of such a comparison? I consider the possibility while staring at a plateful of corkscrew pasta twirling around limp arugula. I imagine the noodles as hairy legs magnified, primavera with a deadly bite. Frozen over my dinner, I ask, who told you that? I don't remember. Someone did. Can I tell you something? He begins again, and I wait for his next revelation. I know the name for the biggest number. It's infinity. But my friends don't believe me. I smile at my young Giordano Bruno, struck by a universe that never ends. But his six-year-old mind grasps the vastness only, not the infinitude. This proselyte is no martyr for open-minded truth. He likes the certainty of naming, satisfied at having contained the largest number ever in a word. He is prepared to defend the humongous truth, turning it into dogma. I think of the symbol for infinity, like a twisted racetrack with banked curves. Never ending, but never leaving either. Turning back into itself, unstretched, speeding through a safely predictable path. Another proclamation of major proportions. The blue whale is the largest animal on Earth. At the Museum of Natural History, he marvels at the relative size of the animal's tail, while my mind tries to comprehend the immensity of the ocean, tries to contain the waters beyond the horizon within the limits of my imagination as the colorful continents on the globe draw boundaries for patches of blue. The world is as large or small as our minds allow. when I try to conceive of waters spacious enough for magnificent whales to roam and dive, something in me unlatches. And so something a little shorter. Some of you may know more about math than I do, but the Fibonacci series or the Fibonacci sequence is something that fascinates me. Essentially, each number is the sum of the two preceding numbers. So it goes 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8. So I use this as a prompt for writing a little poem in which each line is one represents one number on the sequence. By number of syllables. So I went up to 57, no, I didn't. This is, the poem is very short, much shorter than the explanation about the Fibonacci series, and the poem is called The Fib. Yeah, sure, honest, I mean it. I never, you know, but my fingers were crossed at the time. And I've lost my place. As I get older, this is becoming more and more relevant, even though I wrote it a while ago. It's called Slipping. There you are, drifting along a familiar commute, tired from work. You coast down the hill toward the gas station, around the bend, and suddenly, there is no gas station, and the road bends the wrong direction. You are, for just a moment, unsure of where you are, until stopping at a light, you look and see some familiar something, a geranium on a porch, and realize this is not the hill you thought it was. You have mistaken that slight downturn for another hill along the way closer to home. What portal is opened in that long pause when even the familiar looks strange? We live surrounded by a known universe, and one morning the glass in your hand looks thicker than you expect, and you wonder, were those stars always etched there? Did they never catch the light just so? Someone sits across the dinner table, chewing, and you wonder if the beard is new, or was it there on his face all along? So strange. Or swimming in the depths of some rainy day at the end of a dreary patch of February, or during a cold July, and as if in a fog, you forget what month it is and need to concentrate, summer up some anchor in the calendar, so you check the date in the newspaper, settle back to your tea. The feeling passes like a dream about some place from long ago that vanishes behind a veil upon waking, and you wait for it to re-emerge. It doesn't. That's all it takes to know that you are not in control, no matter how well you know the slippery path. Directions veer and lead us into silence, breathless. What if we touch the real there in those places between the cracks, the give in the steering wheel, or the place where the heart skips a beat? In that instant of reeling, after losing your footing on ice, could you let go and slip away, fall for the stranger, find another road home? And one thing about my sweetheart that they probably wouldn't announce is that he's also got a degree in library and information science. I don't know if you wanted that announced, but so this is one that I wrote about Googling. You've probably done it if you Google yourself to find out what's online. I was actually Googling for someone that I knew years ago and trying to find information and stumbled upon all kinds of things about Pamela Herring. And so I just put them together. It's called Red Herrings. I've been trying to find Pamela after 25 years. Turns out she's retired and winters in Gainesville, where she started an art supply company which sells only one product, a non-woven fabric mat for potters. She became a naturopathic physician in Concord, New Hampshire, where she has written many reviews and commentaries on recent innovations in homeopathy and has fought the government for recognition of homeopathic practitioners. She teaches English composition as a regular instructor at the University of Texas at Brownsville, but writes sentimental gospel poems about rainbows and youth, which she has published online. She has been hired as part-time recreation coordinator for Miami Township at $12 an hour. Lost a brother in Georgia and a stepbrother in South Carolina. Had a baby in Las Vegas in September 2001 with husband Arthur. And with husband Peter, also in Las Vegas, was trying to sell her 1990 Honda Accord online for $4,500 and received an offer from James in Lagos, Nigeria, who wanted her to ship the car to him in a shifty scam of counterfeit checks. She wrote a letter to Christianity Today about an article of interest to African Americans like her, touted her prior service record from the U.S. Navy, and her extensive background in construction to promote her services as a real estate agent in Suffolk, Virginia. Was promoted from senior clerk to correctional sentence specialist in the Florida Department of Corrections. Something surely went wrong, and she was arrested and convicted of DUI in the state of Illinois after swerving across the center line, forcing another car up onto the curb to avoid her. She denied drinking anything but cough syrup, but smelled of alcohol, and the jailer said she was belligerent, confused, and emotional. Took off her shoes and asked where they were. She was sentenced to 2 weeks in jail and a hefty fine, reversed by appeal due to a legal technicality. All interesting possibilities for a life of adventure, if they were the same person. But she remains missing, locked in a distant memory, in fact. I've not much to go on from memory alone. She was quiet, smart, played the flute, and was always so graceful in skirts. And I think I'll finish up with one for Mom, who could not be here tonight, but would have if she could have traveled here. It's called Coffee Grounds. My mother fed me scraps of muslin, empty shoeboxes, and wooden spools. I built cardboard cottages, scraped out villages of twigs in the bare dirt of the backyard. She showed me a tattered storybook about little people who lived in an old shoe beneath a rose bush. Sometimes, when alone, I crawled on hands and knees through the violets to peer under the American beauty that grew beside our kitchen stoop, hoping to catch a glimpse of tiny footprints under the waxy leaves. I liked the idea of small people easily hid and longed to discover their secret realm, to be privy to something no one else dreamed of, except perhaps my mother, who stood in the kitchen, silently wiping coffee cups. Didn't she take particular care of the rosebush, dumping cold coffee grounds around its thorny stems to help it grow? I lined up rows of snapped-off sticks, fashioning a house in case it was needed. Flat on my belly, I pressed my chin into black dirt, watching worms wriggle through the coffee grounds with their little secrets. Thank you.
Good evening. First, I would like to thank Adele for having us and for starting and sustaining this wonderful poetry series. And I'd also like to thank the town of Fanwood for supporting it. Indeed. This doesn't happen everywhere. For my first poem, I brought a prop as a bit of an explanation rather than an epigraph, in case, I'm sure most of you know what a Venn diagram is. In case you don't, I brought a little help. It's where you have two things and where they overlap. That's their commonality. In this case, this little green thing represents poets. This larger thing represents civilians. And where they overlap, those are the people who buy poetry books. So now you know what a Venn diagram is. This is called the Venn of everything. Long after we overhear the couple at the next table tell their friends about finding the gay-friendly synagogue they call Shabbat Shebang, we pay our bill and spill into the ever-swirling Venn kaleidoscope of Washington Square. Each of us parts of sets whirling into alignment with sets with which we'd never imagine communion, while putting people into focus with whom we'd never dreamed we'd ever share a common ground. I thought I would start with some poems about moments that Amanda and I shared or where she acted as a muse. With that poem, we were sitting at this table in this restaurant in Greenwich Village, and we were both really quiet, which is very much like us. And she said, I'm sorry if you think I'm ignoring you, but that conversation behind us, and it's like, yeah, I totally understand, because I'm never going to say anything as interesting as what's going on over there. This poem started on the platform of the Cranford train station as we were waiting for the train. It's called The Secret History of New Jersey. It is believed by some that the Apostle Paul sowed the seeds of the first jug handle when he wrote in his much disputed and in some traffic circles deeply discredited second epistle to the Colonians that all turns, even those to the left, should indeed begin from the lane of right. This was written during the brief reign of the vastly underappreciated Emperor Secaucus, who passed through the town now bearing his name to review his troops when the Roman Empire sprawled its most westward after conquering the last Greek diner located on the outskirts of Sparta. After that, history unfurled pretty much as reported, except that nearly a millennium after Paul's letter to the Leonians, Vikings started to settle Cranfjord. While to the south, vandalized villagers commemorized their plight by building a bridge proclaiming, Trenton makes, the world takes. We were on our way to visit Amanda's mom in Western North Carolina, 78 to 81 to 26 to 64. Every chance I had, if Amanda was driving or we were eating, I was scribbling on a piece of paper. And when we got back, I said, could you look at this for me? Because she's an English teacher and she knows semicolons and colons much better than I do. And she read this and she said, we drove all the way there, through the Appalachians, the Smoky Mountains, the Blue Ridge Mountains, and this is what you wrote about. King George Road. Not far from Washington Rock, the Watchung Mountain overlook where the future father of our country observed enemy troop movements runs King George Road, still named for the intolerable tyrant whose oppression sparked the American Revolution. The conspiracy theorist in me wonders, Is the name retained as a grim reminder, or is it a redcoat refuge, a secret society of royalists conspiring to reclaim the colonies for the crown? Just as I'm wary that flowing a mere cannonball shot from the Pentagon is a sixth lane named Jefferson Davis Highway. And of course, you know, when we're traveling on 81 and 78 and such, we hit a lot of rest areas. And to me, they're probably the most democratic places in America. This is called America Achieved Along the New Jersey Turnpike. Although all are not created equal, America's most egalitarian institution is the rest area, where only the display of a handicapped parking tag offers any semblance of advantage. And while we assess the merits of the facility on criteria of cleanliness, perception of safety, refreshment selection, and hand-drying technology, everyone, the biker, the banker, the trooper, the trucker, the lawyer, the laborer, the chauffeur, and the chauffeured, every ripple in the roiling river of humanity called America has to scramble past the temptations of fast food and vending machines to tend to the business. No one, no matter how rich or otherwise powerful, can outsource, ignore, or pay someone under the table to attend to. This is called Foregone. From a highway cut like a ledge in the mountain, we descend through clouds of foliage until we see white steeples and the promise of the old coal town of her youth below. We land on a faded movie set of a downtown where even the graffiti is beaten of bravado and the gauntlet of Norman Rockwell storefronts, empty as the milk cartons skittering along the gutter, are for sale, for rent, foreclosed, forever. Where I work now, I see a lot of textbooks, so I see all the Norton anthology of literature, and you know, all the things that get footnoted, that, you know, things we know now that people won't know about in 10, 20 years. And I imagine a few footnotes in this, like, you know, footnote one, Bennigan's. Once popular restaurant chain. The migration of the butterfly tattoo. A butterfly flashed past my windshield at 70 miles per hour, emerging from the chrysalis of a pair of low rider jeans, its wings revealed from beneath a billowing crop t-shirt, while clinging for life on the back of a Harley, swerving serpentine around the rush hour semis, SUVs, and sedans, riding the jet stream of US-1 and disappearing until I saw it again a half hour down the road, perched in the parking lot of the Bennigan's on the cloverleaf to Route 18. About 10 years ago, we were in San Diego, and this is fairly new. I learned a lesson about a literary icon, native species. We once paid a visit to San Diego, where the ocean and desert meet, creating a climactic conflict that produces plant life that looks like it's been plucked from the pages of a story by Dr. Seuss. We later learn it's Seuss's adopted hometown, and it's obvious the truffula trees that populate the landscapes of his stories were not the fantasy flora of a fervid imagination, but the familiar Monterey cypress he saw outside his window, in whose limbs, perhaps, he observed the native Zinazu bird perched safely out of reach of an indigenous star-bellied sneech that he watched while stroking his own mischievous top-hatted cat. How many remember the original movie, The Blob?
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember the end, what they did to The Blob? Mm-hmm. Yes, they dropped him in the Arctic ice. This is called Sequel. It has an epigraph from Micheline Duclef of NPR News. The record-breaking temperatures melted deep layers of permafrost, and reindeer carcasses, infected with the deadly bacteria, rose to the surface of the thawing mud. Does no one remember The Blob? That gelatinous mass blessed with locomotion well on its way to consuming the population of Pennsylvania until Steve McQueen and his band of brill-creamed cliches saved civilization? How soon we forget how the feds dropped it freeze-dried to submission into the Arctic ice to, in theory, sleep it off for eternity? But now, in spite of the alarms of punctured ozone, melting ice caps, and climate change, we have forgotten there's a giant glob of homicidal jello slowly awakening from its 60-year slumber. So I scan society, looking for a modern misunderstood subset that can suck up the savvy to save us, because Steve McQueen, with his icy blue cool, is long gone. And there's no one left in Hollywood that's hip enough to rescue us again. I now work in Princeton. A couple of poems about the area around where I work. I guess I'd been working there about 10 years when I saw this sign for the first time that apparently had always been there. And this was inspired by that sign. Einstein's geese. Some Princetonians believe that simply living within the 08540 postal zone adds at least 20 points to an IQ. And they must be convinced that even the resident geese that loiter at the office parks and the outskirts of town are literate. How else can one explain the sign? The sign that had to cost enough to feed and clothe a family of four for months in an underdeveloped country. The sign that reads, "No geese," and for added emphasis adds a picture of a goose inside the universal red slashed circle. And being Princeton geese, they ignore the sign anyway, having also inherited that ivied sense of entitlement. While in my neighborhood, the geese lean on the black plywood hunting dog silhouettes meant to discourage them, smoking cigarettes and making goose calls at passing women. And even the park police are intimidated. When you call to complain, they confide in hushed tones. There's nothing we can do. It's best to try to ignore them. This is called assimilation. As with most immigrant groups, after several generations, they're totally acculturated to their surroundings. In this case, an artificial island filling the middle of a swamp disguised as the Princeton office park. On the way to our cars, my colleague notes that they're no longer polite enough to be Canadian geese. Their assimilated honking no longer distinguishable from the irritated sounds emanating from the gaggle of commuters we're about to join on our congested migratory path, commonly known as the Route 1 corridor. Middle age has not been fun so far. I remember a while ago when I turned 40, my pastor said, "Yeah, it's all down here, downhill from here, pal." It took a few years, but I do have to say I probably owe Billy Collins a nickel for every time I read this poem, because, you know, I so ripped him off here. It's called Vulnerable. I'd not noticed the word had gone on vacation, slipping off unannounced to some uncharted precinct of my brain with which I'm not at all acquainted. I'd not noticed it was away until involved in a conversation which could not continue without its participation. A few hours later, after a cheap flight back from the Isle of Aphasia, it unpacked its overnight bag and asked, "Did you miss me?" This is very new. Actually, was accepted by Tom Plant in Exit 13, and it actually might go into the Guinness Book of World Records for most epigraphs in a poem. There are three of them. It's called Echocardiogram Blues. The first epigram: Black people lived right by the railroad tracks, and the train would shake their houses at night. I would hear it as a boy, and I thought, I'm going to make a song that sounds like that. That was Little Richard Penniman. You cannot live without rhythm. Does everybody agree with that? People who don't agree with that are dead. That was Amiri Baraka. And Get Rhythm When You Get the Blues. That's Johnny Cash. Lying on my side on the examining table, we're listening to the blood's whoosh and swoosh as it slowly pulses through the metronome of my heart, when outside the window the wheels of the express to Washington rattle their rhythm along the rails, and my heart wants to be riding Little Richard's locomotive of a piano from Lucille clear through to Bama Lama Bamaloo. But like Johnny Cash, it's still stuck in this Folsom prison, and time keeps dragging on. Last time I read here, I was, I had two eyes that were very nearsighted. Now I have one eye that's very nearsighted and one eye that's very farsighted after several surgeries. And these are reading glasses, but yeah, there are optometrists and eye doctors across the state of New Jersey who discuss my eyes. This is called Guernica. It was homegrown terror and undetected until second grade, when the nurse sent the note home and optometrists prescribed a lifetime of lenses growing incrementally thicker and more complex, masking interior impressionism, until middle age announced itself with a personal meteor shower, inciting the body to attack back, provoking a counterinsurgency, twisting the left eye's response into visions of Guernica. It's surrealism at war with the right's artificially refracted artifice of realism. Two eyes so stylistically opposed, one sees Picasso, the other an Andrew Wyeth, each fighting for primacy in the gallery of my occipital lobe. And a couple more. Last week was a major event in of the year for me. Pitchers and catchers reported to spring training. Yes, I'm a total baseball geek. This is a little bit of history. It's almost a found poem. It's called Kurt Flood. It has an epigraph. I'm pleased God made my skin black. I wish he had made it thicker. It wasn't just the nightly torrent of taunts from fans and teammates alike, or the Jim Crow restaurants and motels during the long rickety Southern League bus rides that finally broke the 19-year-old rookie from the slums of Oakland in 57. It was between games of a doubleheader. Everyone stripped their sweaty, dusty flannels and left them in a pile to be quickly laundered for the nightcap. He watched the clubhouse attendant approach the pile with a long stick, fishing his uniform away from his teammates and at arm's length carry it to the colored-only cleaners across town. While his teammates took the field in their freshly laundered flannels, he sat alone, naked. And finally, I would invite you all home with me, but you'd never find the place. These are pretty much the directions to my house. I live a few minutes from exit 10 of the Jersey Turnpike, where a dozen highways knot like a bowl of asphalt sauce spaghetti, then spew you out in a dozen different directions, rarely the one you've intended, since the road signs mean what they say, but hardly ever say what they mean. And some of our streets are known by at least three names, while the same name is claimed by several very different roads, with at least one being a place you'd never ever want to stop unless your sole source of income or fun involves things that interest mainly undercover cops. So here's what you do. Once you pay the toll, bear right and exit left on the split to 440 South, which becomes 287 North, where you exit for Route 1 South via 531 South, which is also known as Main Street and is not to be confused with 514 East, which you have to pass as it becomes another Main Street. Better yet, get off at exit 9. It's a little out of the way, but a missed turn can't land you on the outer bridge to Staten Island. Thank you.
Amanda Berry and Tony Gruenwalt. Thank you, guys. That was wonderful. It's always such a pleasure to have you here. And Amanda, we're going to find some way to get you into costume again and use your acting skills as well. Before we take our little break, I wanted to make an announcement. March 5th, which is a Sunday, from 3 to 5 in the afternoon, we're going to be doing a book launch here. And it's a posthumous, I can never say that word. It's a book launch for Wendy Rosenberg, who passed away on August 13th. She left a large volume of poems, and before she passed away, she knew she was dying after a valiant struggle with pancreatic cancer. We went through her laptop and pulled out every poem that we could find and put together a book, and Tony was instrumental in making that book happen because he did all of the professional PDFs that most of us were clueless about doing. So anyway, this is the book. It is here, it's done, it's published, it's gorgeous. It's $10 a copy, and all proceeds are going to charity. Her husband, Mark Rosenberg, her daughter, Jacqueline Rosenberg, will be here. There will be a reading of a few of the poems at about 4 o'clock, but it's Sunday, March 5th, from 3 to 5 in the afternoon, and we hope you'll stop by to buy a copy of the book or to just meet Mark and Jacqueline and to just say, you know, we miss you, Wendy, because we really do. She read here several times. Some of you may remember her. Anyway, we're going to take a little break. Did you bring books, guys? Okay, we have books, Amanda's and Tony's. So please relax. There's a sign-up sheet for the open reading, and we'll come back in about 10 minutes.